So by now you're familiar with the guidelines. For all these sessions on valvular heart disease, we keep referring to them. They were most recently upgraded in 2014 with Rick Nishimura and Kathleen Otto as the co-chairs for that. And in acute AI, we're going to first start by looking at the causes, etiologies. And first, we're going to look at acute AI, very interesting disease, one that can really be tricky because you don't always get the classic findings. And of course, the number one, number two, number three, and number four most frequent etiologies of acute AI is endocarditis. Right? That's the one we're going to see as a bread and butter. In your first year, you will see at least one case, but probably will see more than one. Now, there are other causes. An acute type A dissection, of course, can hit the aortic valve and produce significant AI. And then you got very rarely those traumatic situations where the knife went the wrong way and things like that. Actually, I've seen one case in my life of a traumatic acute AI from a catheter. Somebody was a little bit too aggressive trying to cross the aortic valve. So, but those are all very rare situations. So, as I said, endocarditis is really the big one. And the reason why this is important is because these people are sick. They really are sick. They don't look well. And the AI murmur is frequently silent. You don't hear a thing. And, of course, your traditional wide pulse pressures of chronic AI are not there either. So what you have is somebody with a blood pressure of 90 to 100. Now the diastolic may be 40 or 50. So the first tip up is that they do have a low diastolic pressure. But you know, in the heat of the battle, somebody's sick, who pays attention to the diastolic blood pressure? So these people can sit in an ICU for a while without being picked up. So again, these are very, very sick people and the physical findings are often missing. Okay. Here we go. And the reason for that, of course, is they have this they have a systolic pressure that may be 100, 120, and then they have this runoff with a very, very low diastolic pressure and a very rapid increase in the diastolic pressures in the LV, all of which makes the AI murmur hard to hear. And the echo Doppler correlates of that is that when you do the tracing of the AI by CW, it has this very rapid pressure half time, sometimes even going almost down to baseline. And in the mitral end mode, the mitral valve closes very rapidly and there is very little A wave, sometimes no A wave at all. So there are some tip off, and of course, once you see them, and if this patient gets an echo, most of the time, then the diagnosis is properly done. Now, treatment is it's a whole different story. These people do need surgery 99% of the time or they don't survive. And that's a whole different ballgame. They can be very challenging to treat. Now, chronic AI is a different disease. There's a lot of chronic AI. If you rotate to the echo lab in your first day, you'll see at least one, if not 10 AIs. Why? Because a lot of elderly people have a little bit of AI, and that's why this is the most common etiology right here. Degenerative valve, a little bit of calcium, a little bit of focal thickening causes a little bit of AI. So AI comes a dime a dozen, but usually these are elderly folks. They have a lot of other problems besides the AI, and the AI is the least of their problems. Now, that's the most common condition. The second most common, of course, is hypertension with a little bit of aortic root dilation that also can cause some AI. And those are the most common, then followed by bicuspid in the younger people. Then all this other stuff is super interesting, but of course a lot less common, with the exception of aortic aneurysms. So aortic aneurysms, aortic root dilation, that is the Marfan's, that's the other common. So in your practice, you're going to be seeing a lot of degenerative, you'll see some congenitals, and then you'll see some aortopathies. Those are the most common causes of chronic AI, with all these other ones here being very interesting. If you see a syphilis, write it off, because I have not seen one in 30 years. So obviously, that's a disease of the past. features. So with chronic AI, if you have that little bit of AI there, you won't have anything on your physical examination. In fact, most likely, you won't even hear it. You need to have a little bit more AI for even us to hear the typical blowing, diastolic, decrescendo murmur of AI. This disease can go for years. If you have mild to moderate AI, most of the time you die of something else. It's very insidious. The murmur is always present. And as the AI progresses, then you get more and more increasing systolic blood pressure, reduction in diastolic, and therefore your typical wide pulse pressure. Once you get to what we call the real McCoy, the guys that really have that chronic severe AI, then you do get a plethora of findings. You won't have all of them, but you have many of them. You will tend to have the wide pulse pressure. You will have a strong carotid in the pulse, which is the water hammer, which is very prominent, strong carotid. So I like this one. This one we see quite often. This one is also very cute. If you put your finger on the femoral artery and you listen distal to your finger, everybody will hear a bruit. You're creating it with your finger. But if you put your stethoscope proximal to your finger, you should hear nothing. If you have a lot of AI, you gently compress the femoral and you listen proximal, and you're going to hear a beautiful whoosh, whoosh. You see the diastolic recoil coming back. So that's a nice, very simple bedside finding that you can do and look very smart with your attending. The other one, actually, that very few people do because it takes time, but actually can be very helpful, is that as the AI gets worse, the blood pressures in the lower extremities are progressively higher than in the arm. So if you have like 40 or 50 millimeters of difference between legs and arm, the legs being higher, you have significant AI. So that's, again, it's a very simple thing, but it requires having those special cuff that you have to put in the leg and all the goodies that we have sort of lost the art of taking blood pressures in the legs. But it can be also very helpful. Today, people just order an echo. Now, so since we talk about that, I have to tell you, I've been in the business of echo now for four decades at least. And I can tell you that of all the valvular diseases, AI can be one of the most tricky to assess severity by echo. So it's not that easy. And actually, now that we have MRI, not uncommonly, we get an MRI to feel more comfortable with the read. However, having said that, acute AI, no problem. Just people are very sick. The problem is taking care of them, not making a diagnosis once you do an echo. With chronic AI, it's a whole different story. So if you do an angiogram and shoot the aortic root, which hardly we're doing a little bit of it, but not as much. Now with TAVR, we're doing some more. The angiographic criteria really lead a lot to the desire, so much so that in the boards, they were never able to show angiograms and test people because even the experts could not agree. So angiography really has a lot of problems. With echo, then, we look at primarily the proximal behavior of the jet as it comes out of the aortic valve. And the two things we look at is vena contracta, right at the tip of the valve, and in the LVOT, the jet width. And we do that, and there's some absolute measurements, and you can relate it to the diameter. And as you get into your echo rotations, you'll learn more about them. But again, they are problematic. None of them are perfect. So this will be two examples, mild AI. The CW has a very high velocity, slow down slope, where the more severe has a steeper down slope, as you showed earlier. A lot more color dispersion proximally. And then the other thing that can be very helpful, in fact, by TEE, we do it all the time, is looking at the descending aorta for how much blood comes back in diastole. And with milder forms, you get a little bit of early recoil, and then that's it. The more severe you are, the more sustained your recoil is. So when you do TEEs, actually, this can be a very helpful finding because assessing AI severity by TEE is even more challenging than by transthoracic. Everybody think, oh, TEE is a piece of... No. It can be quite tricky to assess severity of AI by TEE. And we find that this can be very helpful. Now, if you have chronic AI and you have the real McCoy, means that you are at least leaking back 35, 40, 50, 60 cc's. If you're still walking, that means that you have to have a lot of stroke volume coming out, right? So you can leak back 50 and still have enough going through your body to be able to enjoy life. So these people have to have very big stroke volumes. Well, if you have a big stroke volume, you either have an EF of 99% or your heart gets bigger. So chronic AI, if it's the real McCoy, practically always is associated with LV enlargement. It has to. It has no other choice. Okay? So you should see LV enlargement, and you should see, if you do quantitation, then you should see regurgitant volumes that are in the range shown here. And that's why quantitation is so helpful, and that's why if we don't feel comfortable quantitating by echo, we often do an MRI these days. But the LV enlargement is an important tip-off. It's an important clue. You cannot have an LV of 4.6 centimeters and have severe chronic AI. It just cannot happen, okay? So that's a very important thing. All right. So how do we do that? Well, we do it with echo Doppler. You'll learn all of this later. We try to compare the flows to the aortic with the flows to the pulmonic or the mitral, and there's tedious and there's room for errors, but it's the best we have. Or today we can do also a CMR and have more accurate assessment of that, which more and more we're doing when we are in doubt. So let's talk about symptoms. These people do well for a long, long time. Vasodilators only help if you're symptomatic and in a short term. They are not recommended for the chronic use. They don't prevent anything. If you have acute AI, you don't want to use an intra-aortic balloon. And of course, these people are very sick. So with chronic AI, mild practically never needs anything. Moderate, even moderate, rarely needs surgery unless a couple of things. Well, if you're going for bypass surgery and you have a solid chronic moderate AI, then the question comes in, do we want to have another operation in 4, 5, 6 years? So that's where you have to, you know, sit down and discuss these things. Occasionally, we have some symptomatic patients with moderate AI, but 95% of those people have pressure overload also. They have AS, in which case AS AI is a whole different ballgame, and that's a disease of its own. And with AS AI, you have a combined pressure volume overload. You could care less about the valve area. If you have a gradient of 45, and on top of that you have moderate AI, you're going to be symptomatic, and you're going to need valve replacement. So with moderate AS AI, all the typical findings are gone by the wayside. What you care about is symptoms, how much gradient, and at least moderate AI. And most of those people are symptomatic. The other one is hypertension. And sometimes you get the 78-year-old lady with blood pressures of 170, moderate AI, and they're very symptomatic. And just like Colin talked about in AS, if you treat their hypertension, quite often, that's all you have to do. So that's why moderate AI rarely needs surgery unless you have a few of those caveats. Now, severe AI, that's the whole different ballgame. And that's when it's a chronic disease, and we now know enough to have some guidelines, decisions about how to intervene. So what do we know about it? Well, the more symptomatic they are, the worse they do. This is an old study shown very clearly symptoms are important. Even class 2 symptoms already does not do as well as class 1, but 2 or 3, 3 or 4, you're in trouble. The other thing we do know nowadays is, if I can get my next slide to work, here we go. So therefore, if you're symptomatic, you should have surgery and it's a class 1 indication. That's a slam dunk, okay? Now, if you have chronic severe AI and you have symptoms, we already said that, class 1. If you are equivocal, you're not sure, just like with AS, a stress test can be very helpful to bring the symptoms, in which case, again, it's a class 1 indication for surgery. If you're asymptomatic, really asymptomatic, you go 9 minutes on the treadmill, you're happy, you play tennis, then this is the important things. It's that asymptomatic people with a normal LV function, i.e. EF over 50%, do well. They progress to symptoms at a rate of less than 6% per year. They progress to LV dysfunction without symptoms at a very low rate, and they basically don't die. I mean, extremely rare. the mortality by surgery would be higher than that. However, once you get an EF that start getting 50, 48, or whatnot, you progress to symptoms very rapidly. And once you're symptomatic, you don't do well at all. So that's the sort of sequence that we follow. Medical follow-up and surgery before you hit this. So what you want to find them is, as they're getting closer to this, you say, okay, let's not wait. Because once we get here, we could be in trouble. So how do we know that somebody is approaching this stage of LV dysfunction? Well, it looks like the best parameter for that is LV dilation. Now, the reason why that's important is because people who go to surgery with LV dysfunction, they, as you can see, don't do quite as well in years after AVR. So if you replace a valve with an EF of 45%, it's better than replacing it with 30%, but no longer that patient does as well as if you have replaced the valve when they had an EF of 57%. So that's one of the reasons you want to catch them before that happens. And likewise, they have a much higher incidence of after valve replacement heart failure. So what has been shown, and this is very old data, Bob Bono was a young man when he did this at the NIH, and he's now one of the most senior guys in cardiology. He showed very nicely by following over 100 patients very, very diligently that progressive end-systolic dilation was the key. And as the end-systolic diameter got progressively bigger, the risk became higher. And the magic number was about 5. And that has led to the guidelines, which have been relatively similar for the past 15 years. This is the last, from the last 2014, the figure on that, is that if you have severe AI, again, symptomatic, you should have surgery. Asymptomatic with a good EF, asymptomatic with a EF under 50, likewise, you should have surgery. Asymptomatic with a decent EF, then you follow the end-systolic diameter. And as the end-systolic diameter gets close to at 5 or more, definitely that becomes an indication for surgery. Now, some people also talk about the end-systolic diameter being greater than 65 millimeters. Those are big hearts. In fact, the biggest hearts seen in medicine for centuries have been the hearts of chronic AI. So this is the sequence. It hasn't changed for many years. The figure is a little different than in the previous guidelines, but it's basically the same concept. Some caveats. Since you're going to be following dimensions and measurements of the heart, you have to be very obsessive about technology, qualities, reproducibility. The echo has to be done with meticulous techniques, preferably in the same place. And 2D dimensions today, we think are superior to ENMODE because ENMODE has a lot of problems. And then consider MRI when you are in doubt, because you can get also very accurate volumes and dimensions by MRI.